magnify your name.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Put your hands together. Put your hands together.
Hallelujah.
And his goodness to us.
Yes.
At this time, we want to ask for the saints to gather together. Let us bring our minds in at this time. We want to focus our attention on the Creator.
Yes.
I want to say welcome to the eighth day celebration.
Yes. Amen.
We have just finished 7 days of Sukkot. And the scripture teaches us that the eighth day after that last day of Sukkoth is a holy convocation.
Yes, God.
And so we have gathered today to honor the King and to give the Most High praise and magnification.
Yes,
that's due to his glorious name. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes, give the Most High a clap offering. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Bless the Holy One. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
At this time, I want to ask our dear sister if she would come and blow the shofar, and then we're going to have a word of prayer.
Yes. Yes, God.
Let us all stand. I want to also say welcome to those who are watching us by live stream. I want you to know that your attendance is welcome, and we trust that the Almighty will minister to you as you connect with us wherever you might be, all over the world, and share with us in this eighth day celebration.
Yes.
This time we're going to bow our heads in a word of prayer.
Yes, God.
Abba Yah, we do thank you. We bless you. We glorify you for your mercies, your
God.
Kindness, and your goodness to us. We thank you that you are Elohim all by yourself, that there is none like you. We thank you for the forgiveness of sins that we have. We thank you for the spilled blood of our Redeemer, Yahshua, our King. We thank you for bringing us to this time, this season of this Moed, the last, at the end of the year, the end gathering.
Yes.
We praise you for the significance in the message that you give to us.
Yes, God.
And we ask, Abba, that you would strengthen and prepare your people, that as they learn of your ways and understand your purposes that you have revealed in all of your word and in all of your Moedim, that we might prepare ourselves for the coming of our King.
Yes, God.
We thank you for this opportunity that we can gather together to be able to honor, to worship, to celebrate, and to receive from you. Now, Abba, we do thank you in advance, and we pray that you would be glorified in everything that is accomplished. In the mighty name of Yahshua, our Messiah.
Yes, God.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Bless the Holy One of Israel.
Yes.
Hallelujah. This time we want to remain standing. We want to read the scripture text, which is found in the book of Leviticus, chapter 23. Leviticus chapter 23. We're going to go to verse 33 through 43. When we celebrate the eighth day, it is in conjunction with the seven-day Sukkot celebration, so we want to read those same passages that speak to this Moedim, or this Moed. Leviticus chapter 23, beginning at the 33rd verse. Blessed be his great name.
Yes,
yes.
Yes, God.
Yahuwah spoke to Moses, saying, say to the Israelite people, on the 15th day of this seventh month, there shall be a feast of booths, Sukkot,
yes,
to Yahuwah for 7 days. The first day shall be a sacred occasion or holy convocation. You shall not work at your occupations. 7 days you shall bring offerings by fire to Yahuwah. On the eighth day you shall observe a sacred occasion and bring an offering by fire to Yahuwah. It is a solemn assembly. You shall not work at your occupations. These are the set times of Yahuwah that you shall celebrate as sacred occasions or holy convocations, bringing offerings by fire to Yahuwah, burnt offerings, meal offerings, sacrifices, and libations on each day what is proper to it, apart from the Sabbaths of Yahuwah, and apart from your gifts, and from your votive offerings, and from all your freewill offerings that you give to Yahuwah. Mark on the 15th day of this seventh month, when you have gathered in the yield of your land. This is in gathering. You shall observe the festival of Yahuwah 7 days, a complete rest on the first day and a complete rest on the eighth day. This is the eighth day.
Yes.
And so it's a set apart day. On the first day, you shall take the product of hadar trees, branches of palm trees,
yes,
boles of leafy trees, and willows of the brook, and you shall rejoice before Yahuwah your Elohim 7 days.
Yes, God.
You shall offer it as a festival of Yahuwah for 7 days in the year, and you shall observe it in the seventh month as a law for all time throughout your generations. You shall live in booths 7 days. All citizens in Israel shall live in booths in order that future generations may know that I made,
yes,
the Israelite people live in booths when I brought them out of the land of Egypt. I, Yahuwah, am your Elohim. Blessed be the mighty one of Israel. You may have,
yes,
your seats.
Yes,
God.
Hallelujah.
Yes, God.
We bless the Almighty for this season and are so grateful for the opportunity to be able to celebrate.
Yes.
To come together and to remember,
yes,
what the Almighty has commanded. Today is the eighth day.
Yes.
And so we have gathered today to consider in the purpose of Elohim what this day means. I want to take a few moments to provide an explanation concerning this eighth day celebration, and then afterwards I'm going to have my wife to come and she's going to lead us in our praise and worship time. But I want us to be able to see the significance of the eighth day.
Yeah.
The Most High told us that 7 days we are to dwell in booths,
yeah.
Sukkahs. And after the seventh day,
yes.
When the dwelling in booths had ceased,
yes.
We enter the eighth day. The interesting thing about this is that the Almighty did not say the first and the seventh day would be the days that would be holy convocations.
Yeah.
It would seem that that might be reasonable. But what he said is that the eighth day shall be
yeah.
the set-apart day. After the dwelling in booths has been completed. And that is because the eighth day,
yeah.
the number eight, represents new beginnings.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
When we go through a week, 7 day week, according to the scriptures.
Yes.
A new week begins, or the week is renewed with the first day cycle commencing the new week.
Yes.
But in all actuality, that is the eighth day. So when we look at the eighth day symbolically, it represents new beginnings.
Yes.
It represents a new age. It represents a new cycle, or I like to use the term a renewed cycle.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
The reason why I use this term renewed is because when we begin to understand terminology from the Hebrew perspective and definition, the term new, as it's translated in English, means literally to renew mm-hmm. in Hebrew.
Yes, indeed.
You can't say new in Hebrew. You can only say renew in Hebrew. Mm-hmm. And the reason why that is the case is because when Elohim created everything, that is our reference point, he created everything complete. He created everything so that it would sustain. And there is nothing that can be added to it. So what happens is when any aspect of his creation
yeah.
has been corrupted, what he does is renew it. Because he made everything perfect. And so we see that the eighth day is the day of renewing.
Yes, yes.
Renewing. Everyone say renewing.
Renewing.
That's what it represents. It represents Elohim setting things back in place according to the original design. That's what this is all about.
Mm-hmm.
It's about Elohim restoring everything back to the original design. So the eighth day celebration has to do with a renewal, and it points to the Messianic kingdom age where Messiah will rule and reign on the earth, and we who are his, we will rule and reign with him as Elohim had intended at the beginning through Adam. See, this is the goal of the Father. It's all about restoration. Did you know that?
Yes, yes.
Some would say, I thought it was all about salvation. Salvation is a part of the overall plan of restoration. Elohim's plan is much larger than what we really understand it to be. We're delivered from sin so that we can rule and reign as he intended. See, that's the intention of the Almighty. That's why when we read in the scriptures and it teaches us that they shall be kings and priests, that's the original intention of the Almighty, is that we be kings and priests, that we govern over the creation that he made, and that we serve him because we are a Kohanim, or a priesthood unto him. So our governing over the works of his hands, it is done as a service unto him, which means that it is done as a means of giving the glory back to him.
Yes.
The problem we have in our age today is that men have decided to rule over the works of Elohim's hands, but leave him out of the equation. Mm-hmm. See, it is the intent of Elohim that we rule over the planet. It is his intention that we rule over the works of his hands.
Yes, it is.
But not without him. So we are what? Kings and priests.
Yes, amen.
Unto who? Our Elohim. And so the eighth day celebration, it's a celebration that gives us a snapshot of what we're to go into.
Yes, amen.
Every year when we celebrate, it is a snapshot. It is a picture that we see to help us to be reminded of what the Most High has initially intended for us. See, you're not just saved just to exist. You're not just saved and spending the rest of your life hoping and waiting to go to heaven. You're not just saved and living here trying to figure out what your purpose is. But you have been saved so that you can prepare yourself to rule, to reign, and to serve.
Amen.
The Most High. To rule with the Messiah.
Yes, yes.
So Zion, listen. Right now, while we are awaiting his return, let me clue you in on something. It is very important that in the interim that we are in, that you do your very best to serve him, to give yourself to his work. Because whether you realize it or not, I'm trying to help you here, whether you realize it or not, your work now, your obedience now, is going to determine your place in the kingdom. Did y'all hear me? So those of you who are still kind of debating whether you're going to do that service unto the Almighty that's been revealed to you, those of you that are kind of straddling the fence to do the work of the ministry that you've been called to, those of you that you say, well, I'll just do it later. Your doing it later might cost you. Hear me today. Because this kingdom that we go into, there's going to be those, as the Messiah said, would be given three cities, five cities, 10 cities. And the basis of their particular status in having dominion and ruling in the kingdom is based upon their service here and in the now. That's why it's very important that if the Almighty has revealed to you your giftings and callings, you need to be about the business of the Father. Now, overseer here, I caught that revelation years ago. So when I caught that revelation and caught that understanding, I recognized that I'm going to keep my hands on the plow. And it doesn't matter what challenges, it doesn't matter what persecutions, it doesn't matter if your husband don't act right, if your wife don't act right, it doesn't matter if your friends don't act right, it doesn't matter if you have family members that are against you in your walk and in your serving of the King, you need to be about the Father's business. Hallelujah. Amen.
Hallelujah.
You need to be about the Father's business. So I want to encourage Zion today. Hallelujah. We're here celebrating this feast, and it's wonderful that each of you are here. It's wonderful to see your faces, and I'm glad that you have decided to be here in obedience to the Creator. But, you know, I can't let you get away without having to admonish you in truth. Because when Yahshua comes, he's going to call every one of us in Zion into account. Like he did with those three servants that he gave the talents to. How many of y'all read that? Amen. The talent was a certain amount of money. That's what it was. For those who might not be familiar, sometimes we think of the term talent. And we think, oh, it's some kind of gift I have. I can do this, I can do that, you know, like singing or dancing or writing or something. But the talent in the scripture was a particular amount of money. It represented a certain amount of wages. When I looked it up, I discovered that the talent, one talent, say in today's money, would probably be something around about between maybe I think $200,000 to $300,000, roughly. So one servant was given one, another servant was given three, another was given what? Five, I believe it was. The servant that was given the one, he just buried it in the ground, didn't do anything with it. The other two worked that money and was able to produce more, right? When the master came back, he went to the first servant. He was expecting to receive something, right? He was expecting to receive something. And notice when you look at the text, he said, well, I know what you expected, but, you know, I just... hit it in the ground so I can make sure that I didn't lose anything. He said, here's your money. He called him a wicked, listen, he called him a wicked and slothful
Amen.
Servant. He said, you could have at least taken the money and given it to the exchangers. In other words, you could have invested that money and got a return on it. Just put it in the bank. A small interest rate over time you stick $200,000 in the bank and let that sit for a few years or so. You're going to get something off of that. That's going to increase quick, right? And this is what the master was saying. This kind of makes sense to everybody. See, and what he was trying to share was that in our lives, the Most High has given to us talents. He's given to us giftings of great value, and he expects us to use them. So I want to encourage you, Zion, use what he's given you. Whether you think it's of great value or not, use what he's given you. Because we want to be ready when he comes, and we want to be able to look him in the face and wait for him to say to us, here's your city to rule over. There's going to be a whole world for us to rule over. You catching this? Are y'all catching this? We are the ones who will rule and reign with him. Does this make sense? We talk about going into the kingdom. Yay, we're going to go into the kingdom. We're going to the kingdom. Who do you think is going to be ruling and reigning and running? Messiah and us. So I just want to leave you something to think about as we consider the significance of this 8th day celebration. Well, we bless his name today. Hallelujah. And we're going to prepare ourselves for our time of praise, worship, and singing. Hallelujah. His great name is worthy to be praised. I am excited today that my wife is going to be sharing the word. Hallelujah. I always enjoy when she has opportunity to share and to minister the word. I always look for something different and look for a different perspective on something, a fresh nugget that I might not see. Hallelujah. But at this time, we're going to receive her. She's going to lead us in our time of praise and worship. Hallelujah.
Amen. Bless the Almighty. Hallelujah.
Amen.
I'm going to play a couple from here. We'll start with that one. Amen. Shalom, shalom.
Yes.
Shalom. Bless the Lord. We are so grateful to be in the house of worship. Amen. To everyone. Thank you all for pressed your way and came out in the midweek service. I feel sometimes midweek services are tough for those who have to go about their lives, but we thank the Lord that the Most High has asked us to set aside this time to come together and to commemorate and to celebrate these feasts. So we are thankful to be here. We're grateful. Amen. So we're just going to do a few songs. We're not going to hold you very long with this segment, but we're just going to do one or two on today. Go ahead and we're going to do Hallelujah. We just... Yes,
Amen.
This time is about us
dedicating
our lives to
the
Lord.
And purify me.
Yes, Lord.
Purify me. Create in me a clean heart and soul. May you worship me. Thank you.
Hallelujah. He wants a pure vessel.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Yes, yes, yes.
Yes.
The next song says total praise. We give you everything on today, Lord. That's what this season is all about. Hallelujah.
Bless the Holy One of Israel. Bless the Holy One of Israel. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We lift up our hands before you.
Hallelujah.
And offer you total praise. Our vessels that are made themselves pure and holy before you.
Worship you.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Yahuwah be praised. Elohim Sabbath.
Your holy name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Back to your hands, Pastor Mo. Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
Oh,
thank you, great name.
Praise your great name, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, great
name, Lord. Hallelujah.
Thank you,
praise
Jesus.
Your great name.
The Most
yes.
High.
Yes.
Goodness to us.
Yes.
For the opportunity we have to praise Him.
Yes.
To sing to Him.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Scripture teaches us it's a good thing to give thanks.
Yes. Yes.
A good thing.
Yes.
It's a functional thing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Something that we're supposed to do.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes, it is.
His great
Bless
name be
his
praised.
Great name.
Yes.
Well, at this time, I want us to prepare our hearts for a song. Hallelujah. Bless the Almighty.
Yeah.
And while we're getting ready for that, I want us to be mindful of this season that we are in.
Yes.
This season right now, you notice that there's a lot of rain that we have at this time. And one of the things that's significant about this 8th day celebration is that when Israel would come to the temple in Jerusalem and have this celebration, there would be water pots that would be stacked, water pots. And at a certain time in the celebration, the water pots would be tipped over for the waters to flow. The idea of the waters flowing is representative of the season. When ingathering takes place, you get ready for the rains. You get ready for the waters to come. And that is what brings about the spring. After the winter and the rains and the snow and all of that comes to the earth, it prepares the ground for spring, for renewed life. New beginnings. And I'm sure that my wife will probably go into more detail with regard to this. But we are seeing things happening in our time that is all reflective of the message that the Almighty is trying to show and convey to us.
Yes.
Hallelujah. So I just want to encourage us that as you look and as you see what is occurring in the seasons, begin to consider the larger and spiritual meaning that the Most High has for us, because He is always speaking. Amen?
Amen.
He is always speaking. Hallelujah. Glory to His name.
Amen.
Well, at this time, we want to prepare ourselves for a song. We have a young sister with us here today who is going to share a solo prior to the ministry of the word.
Yes.
And I want everyone to encourage her.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
And just let her know that it's all right.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Sometimes young people, when they come before an audience,
yes,
they might be a little nervous, but you're among family.
Yes.
So you sing as unto the Almighty. I'm going to present to you our dear sister, Sophia, if you would come and share your song with us.
Yes. Thanks, Sophia.
Okay.
Amen.
Lives in that matter. Hallelujah. Well, this time I'd like for us to be prayerful and to ask the Almighty to anoint my beloved as she comes and shares the scripture with us today. I believe that there is a word in her mouth. And I'd like to ask for us to have an open spirit and an open heart to receive the word of Elohim today. So, without any further ado, I want to introduce to you my wife,
Kimberly Mode, and she's going to come and share the word. Hallelujah. Put your hands together.
Amen. My daughter.
Well, amen. We bless the Almighty. See you again. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise His great name. I am grateful. Amen. That song really touches me. It was a beautifully rendered one today.
Yes.
You know, and that's what He wants. Amen. All the songs that we're talking, singing today, and things we're talking about today, has to do with giving our lives and our wholeness to the Lord. I said on last Sabbath that, you know, you can read a scripture for years and years, and then one day it really impacts you differently.
Yes, yes, you know, that's right.
We read in Matthew, is it Mark chapter 12 that we read, or Matthew chapter Mark 12, 28, and that we should love the Lord with all of our heart, our mind, our soul, and all of our strength. You know, and that's everything that is a part of us, is
yes.
How we should be loving the Lord on today. Amen.
Amen.
I'm not going to be up here very long on today. We're just going to cover a few points on our subject of Feast of Tabernacles on tonight. I'm just grateful for this season. Another year the Lord has commanded us to remember and to commemorate these times.
Yes.
These are His set times. These are not dates that we created or that we decided were important to us, but these were actual dates that the Most High Himself said that they were important to Him, and that we wanted throughout all of our generations to commemorate and to celebrate these set times. Amen. Before we go any further, we're going to go ahead and just give a word of prayer on today, that the Most High would cover us, cover our thoughts and what was going to be shared on today. Amen. So let's go ahead and bow in a word of prayer on tonight. Father Yah, we thank You for this opportunity, and we do call it an opportunity to come before Your people tonight. Father, we ask that You would give us ears to hear. Give us a mouth to speak. Lord, give us words of what to say. Father, if You don't fill the mouth with what to say, we won't have anything to say on this evening. But Father, we know that You have given us words from Your divine scripture to say and to meditate on and to take, to apply to our lives. We ask that You would do that in us tonight. Allow Your word.
Yes
Lord.
Yes,
as we think about Your temple, Your tabernacle, and how we can mirror everything, Lord, that You see in the heavenlies. You want to look down in the earth and see in the earth. You want to look down and see in the earth realm. Father, Yah, things that remind You of where You are in the heavens. Father, we ask that You would look upon us tonight and that You would allow us to be pleasing in your sight.
Yes.
In Yeshua's name, amen, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Bless God Almighty. We thank Him.
Amen. Yes.
Hallelujah. We're going to ask right now that we would go to the book of 2 Chronicles. And we're going to start there, chapter 6. You have your word. However you get your word, whether you get it by your scriptures we have here, or whether you use your audio or your electronics. We have so many ways to receive our word on these days. We are in a blessed time in our lives.
Yes.
Do you remember a time when the people would be, I was reading and studying and listening to documentaries about the Dark Ages, and you know, they didn't have everything we have today, and so many of them have died and were killed just for opening up a Bible in their home, or opening up a Bible, having a possession of one. And here we are, we have it so easily accessible to us, and it is a great and wonderful thing.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
So we'll just give a little bit of a build up onto the passage and the text that we're going to cover on to today. But everyone knows about David, and who was the king over all of Israel.
Yes.
And he was was a man after the Most High's own heart, and he was also a man of war. He conquered. If you know your history about Jerusalem, you know that he conquered all of the area, the territories around him. He, for so many years when he was king, until he brought them into a place of safety. They no longer had to be afraid of the Philistines coming after them or any other nations surrounding them.
Yes.
He brought all of that safety to them. And so after he looked around and he said, you know, we're in a settled place. We're in our land. We have walls of safety around us. And he decided that he wanted to do something. He wanted to build a temple for Elohim, for the Lord Most High.
Yeah.
And he spoke those words, and he spoke those words out and said that he wanted to build the Lord a temple. But the Most High sent word to David, and he said, you know what, David? I'm not going to allow you to build me this temple or this place where I will rest myself there. And he said, first of all, I never asked for that. He said, I've been dwelling in a dark cloud.
Yeah.
You know, and like when they were over in the tabernacle wandering through the wilderness, he was over them in the form of a cloud. At night, he'd show up in the pillar of fire. But he said, I never asked for a place to put my presence there. And he said, but you know what? He said, because you have said this is your desire, I'm going to honor that. He said, but he told David, he said, I'm not going to allow you to be the one to build me a temple because you have too much, you encountered too much blood. You were in too many wars and you were in so much, so he didn't have the qualifications in terms of what the Most High was looking for to build him that temple. But he told him, he gave David a promise, and he said that he would allow his son to do that, to build this temple for him. And he said, not only that, but I am going to give you a legacy, so much so that you will forever have a man on the throne, you know. And so he told him that, told that promise to David. So David went to work. You know, we hear about Solomon's temple is called that, but really in actuality, the plans for that, according to 1 Chronicles chapter 28, you read through all that, David, he was the one who set up the plans for it. He had the vision for every bit of it. He wanted to not only just have a temple to be there, but he also wanted the elements to go into it. He had prescribed everything for it, and he also wanted to have a place where the singers would come and the priests. They had all of those who had gifts and talents would come in.
Yes.
And they were going to bring praise to the Most High and give up their gifts and their talents, and the priests would be should have the trumpets, and they would play. And when the sacrifice was being, when sacrifices were going to be made, there will be, we don't hear or really get an idea about what all was happening in the background. We know about the priests who presented the offerings and made the sacrifices, but there was praise going on at the same time.
Yes.
There was singing going on. There was a choir David had wrote songs for the choir to sing. There were other musicians that accompanied David, and they all had their harps. And so there was a lot that David had in mind that he wanted to see, that all of this would take place. But he was not the one to bring it to pass. There's so much in this. I'm just summarizing because it is so involved. If you ever wanted to understand between the 1st and 2nd Kings and everything that of the history in 1st Kings regarding David and the temple, and then Solomon going about to build this great temple for the Most High's presence.
Yes.
Amen. That is so important.
Yes.
Amen. So we're going to read. So starting in chapter 2 Chronicles chapter 6, we're going to do a little bit of reading here. And we'll start with verse 1. It says, then Solomon said, the Lord has said that he would dwell in a dark cloud. I have built a magnificent temple for you, a place for you to dwell forever. Now, before this is when he's coming to this place in chapter 6 where he's beginning to decided that they're going to come together and dedicate this great temple that they had built. And he had skilled people from all over coming over to come to this, to come to do the work in Jerusalem. The details of this temple was so specific, and it was so so much detail. If you read all of Second Chronicles, the first 1-5, and you'll see all of the details that went into building this great work. And even when you see when he prepares the ark, they made the for the Ark of the Covenant to be placed in the Holy of Holies, the most holy place. The details that went into it. Amen. I'm going to read just chapter 5, verse 7 real quick, and then we'll pick back up in chapter 6. But it said, the priest then brought the Ark of the Lord's Covenant to its place in the inner sanctuary and of the temple, the most holy place, and put it beneath the wings of the cherubim. Now, if you understand about this, the cherubim, it was supposed to emulate what was in the heavenlies, what was in the holy place where the most holy throne is, with the Abba Yah sits on the throne. Yeah. And so this cherubim was supposed to appear as though they were like the angels who cover the throne. So the 20 cubits, they had two angels on each side, the wings extended, so that if you look at 20 cubit feet, so it would be one cubit is like from their elbow to, not me personally, but it probably would have been the king's. So they did the measurements like that. So you'd have five, and then another five, and then two more. So five, each wing was five cubits, so that a whole span was 20 cubits long, and I'm told somewhere between 17 and 20 inches, depending on what phase of where you were in time. So Solomon built his temple according to what they call the old cubit. So it would have been somewhere between 17 and 18 inches. So that distance would have been how far the wings spanned it. And so it was from one end of the tabernacle wall, and then the other wing of the second cherubim would hit the other tabernacle wall. So there was no gap, no space in between that. And then in front of that was the Ark of the Covenant that they placed there. And it said the cherubim spread their wings over the place of the ark and covered the ark and its carrying poles. These poles were so long that their ends extended from the ark.
My God.
Could be seen from in front of the inner sanctuary, but not from outside the holy place. And they are still there according to this time, to that time.
Yeah.
There was nothing in the ark except the two tablets that Moses had placed in it at Horeb, where the Lord made a covenant with the Israelites after they came out of Egypt.
Yeah.
All right, so let's go ahead. We're going to read in 2 Chronicles chapter 6. So now everything is in place. Now, if you could just see the scene, it comes to the day where they've decided that they're going to dedicate. It's that time where they come to dedicate, and it was during this season, a Feast of Tabernacles, that everything was prepared. Now, I want you to understand that. Everything was prepared and ready, and they were not only going to commemorate or remember this Feast of Tabernacles, but they were also going to dedicate the actual living tabernacle that they had built for the Lord's presence.
Yeah.
Amen. So he says to the Lord, I have built a magnificent temple for you. What better time would it be to dedicate this tabernacle, but during this season of Feast of Tabernacles. Amen?
Amen.
He says, while the whole assembly of Israel was standing there, the king turned around and blessed them. Then he said, praise be to the Lord, the God, or the Yah of Israel, who with his hands has fulfilled what he promised with his mouth to my father David. For he said, verse 5, since the day I brought my people out of Egypt, I have not chosen a city in any tribe of Israel to have a temple built for my name to be there. Now you should underline that. For my name or my presence or my existence to be there. A representation of who he is to be there. Nor have I chosen anyone to be leader over my people Israel. Yeah. But now I have chosen Jerusalem for my name to be there. And I have chosen David to rule my people Israel. My father David had it in his heart, this is Solomon, to build a temple for the name of the Lord, the Yah of Israel. But the Lord said to my father David, because it was in your heart to build a temple for my name, you did well to have this in your heart. Nevertheless, you are not the one to build the temple, but your son, who is your own flesh and blood. He is the one who will build a temple for my name.
Yes.
The Lord has kept the promise he made. I have succeeded David, my father, and now I sit on the throne of Israel, just as the Lord promised. And I have built the temple for the name of the Lord, the Yah of Israel. There I have placed the ark in which is the covenant for the Lord that he made with the people of Israel. Amen.
Yes.
So here we have this temple being dedicated, not only the temple, but the articles inside of it.
Yes.
The covenant, the ark of the covenant represents the covenant, the relationship that the Most High was going to keep with his people. It's all represented and it's all present here. And what a sight this was. Now, not only were they dedicating this tabernacle, this temple, but they were also coming together and they gave a great sacrifice. If you keep reading through here, it talks about how many lambs and goats and bulls and everything that was being brought forth to be sacrificed before the Lord Most High. It was dedicated in great fashion.
Yes.
It was in all of the dedication that went forth. We'll read a little bit of that as we go along. Hallelujah. But it was a magnificent sight. And so much so, not only did the inner part of the temple to be dedicated, but with Solomon, he went one step further. It says he built a platform.
Yeah.
He wanted to pray so all the people would see him bow before the Lord and bow on this platform. And as he bowed down, he began to say the words. And I'm going to read, we're going to read a lot of this prayer that Solomon prayed before the Lord as he was dedicating this temple before the Lord. He was also praying for the assembly and for the people.
Yes.
Because who understands? It's okay to have a building. It's okay to have something that you're giving over to the Lord, but not only that wasn't all that the Most High wanted. He wanted a people that would celebrate him, that would give him the invitation to be in their midst. Amen? So there were some things that was going to go along with this that Solomon understood. It says, then Solomon stood in verse 12 before the altar of the Lord in front of the whole assembly of Israel and spread out his hands. Now he had made a bronze platform, 5 cubits long, 5 cubits wide, and 3 cubits high, and had placed it in the center of the outer court. He stood on the platform and then knelt before the Lord, knelt down before the whole assembly of Israel and spread out his hands towards heaven.
Yes.
And he said, here's what he said. O Lord, God or Yah of Israel, there is no Elohim like you in heaven or on earth. You keep your covenant of love with your servants who continue wholeheartedly in your way. You have kept your promise to your servant David, my father. Here he says it again.
Yes.
With your mouth you have promised and your hands you have fulfilled it as it is today. Now, Lord, he's petitioning him. Elohim of Israel, keep for your servant David, my father, the promises you made to him when you said, you shall never fail to have a man to sit before me on the throne of Israel. If only your sons are careful in all they do to walk before me according to my law, as you have done. And now, O Lord, Yah Israel, Elohim, let your word that you promised your servant David come true. But will God really dwell on the earth with men? That's the question he wanted to ask. It just seems like an, I mean, I knew he must have believed that he went through all of the trouble. Do you know all the expense that it went to putting this temple together? I mean, all of everything that they had to bring over by ships from Lebanon, you know, and they sent the logs over, all the work, all the gold that they collected from the people.
Yes.
Everything. The what will it matter? What does it matter to have all of this outward appearance and everything? And yes, sure, all the nations around and see, they can come and visit and see everything that we have done, all that, the labor we have done to do this. But would it really make any difference if the Most High, Yah, did not really come down? Can you imagine? That would have been a really poor day if they set this stage for him to come and be a part of to fill this place. Now, we know he hovered. They knew about his presence being over the tabernacle with Moses and taking the people through Israel. They knew all of their history. So why would he even have to ask this question? But will you really dwell on earth with men? We know you're in heaven. And we know you appear to many, but would he really come to earth to dwell with men?
Yes.
The heavens, even the highest heavens, cannot contain you. How much less this temple I have built. You know, he looked at it and he thought, you know, maybe this won't be a big enough place. Maybe it won't be enough. Maybe it's just, you know, you can feel inadequate. But from a man's perspective, if I were building this for a man, it will be all right, he probably thought. If I was just building this for a king, or for myself, then it's probably going to be just fine.
Yes.
But when he had to stop and think of, who are we building this for? We're talking about the king of the universe, and we are inviting him to come into this house. Will it be enough? Will it be adequate enough? How much less this temple I have built? Yet give attention to your servant's prayer and his plea for mercy. Oh, Lord, my Yah Elohim, hear the cry and the prayer that your servant is praying in your presence. May your eyes be open towards this temple day and night, this place of which you said you would put your name there. May you hear the prayer that your servant prays towards this place.
Yes.
Hear the supplications of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray towards this place.
Yes.
Hear from heaven, your dwelling place. And when you hear, forgive. He's petitioning for on behalf of the people, saying, Lord, when he's going to go into more detail if you read through all of this.
Yes.
He says, Lord, when we come before you, and we bring you sacrifices, receive them, do all of these things. He's praying as he says all of this. And he says further down, declare the innocent not guilty, and so establish his innocence. When your people, Israel, have been defeated by an enemy because they have sinned against you, and when they turn back and confess your name, praying and making supplication before you in this temple, then hear from heaven and forgive the sin of your people, Israel, and bring them back to the land and you gave them and their fathers. Amen. He goes on and on and on in this prayer because he wants to supplicate the Lord and ask him and petition him to hear these people.
Yes.
Hear us and receive us. Let's go to verse 32. He not only was praying on behalf of native-born people and citizens, but he also covered foreigners And he said in verse 32, going down, and he says, as for foreigners who does not belong to your people, Israel, but has come from a distant land, even though who come from afar,
yes.
And they want to kneel down and bow before this temple.
Yes.
He says, because of your great name and your mighty hand and your outstretched arm, when he comes and prays towards this temple,
yes.
Then hear from heaven, your dwelling place, and do whatever the foreigner asks of you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you as your own people Israel, and may know that this house I have built bears your name. Why was it so important that he wanted the world to know that this house that we have built,
yes.
bears his name? Because it's a great name.
Yes.
There is no other name like our Elohim, our Yah. There is,
yes.
no other name.
Under
the heaven or the sun, there is no other name. Amen. By which anybody,
yes.
can be received or can be saved or can be healed. You know, there's many that call on all their names. But they understood that there was no greater name.
Yes.
There was no greater presence. There was no greater person, no one greater than our Yah Elohim. Amen. Amen. And he also goes on to say, there may come a time when we have sinned and we have done wrong and we act unwisely and we act wickedly. And he said, if your people, and if they turn back to you, in verse 38, with all their heart and soul, he said, we may be taken captive. He was trying to cover all the scenarios that could happen, that could take place in their history. He must have understood these people, that they don't always listen. They don't always do what's right.
Amen.
There have been many things that they've done.
Yeah.
You know, he was trying to cover with this prayer everything, no matter where we are. Even if we're not in this land and we're taken and we're scattered and we go across and our captor takes us far,
yeah.
away. Glory. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
He says, captive where they were taken. If they pray, no matter the land, if they look towards, they don't even have to have their foot in the land, but if they just turn in the direction of where this great place is, he said by faith, he just was believing that the Most High would honor.
Yeah.
He said, if they were to pray towards the land you gave their fathers, toward,
yeah.
the city you have chosen,
by faith.
And toward the temple I have built for your name, then from heaven, your dwelling place, hear these people,
yes.
and their pleas, and uphold their cause, and forgive your people who have sinned against you. Now, my Elohim, may your eyes be open and your ears attentive to the place, to the prayers offered in this place. Amen.
Yes.
He
Amen.
Says, and then we all know this great scripture, and we sing about it, and there's songs that says, now arise, O Lord.
Yes.
Yes.
He says, look, if you're going to come, we pray, we cover everything. He says, now arise, O Lord, and come to your resting place.
Yes.
You and the ark of your might. May your priests, O Lord, Elohim, be clothed with salvation. May your saints rejoice in your goodness. O Lord, do not reject your anointed one. Remember the great love promised to David, your servant. Amen. So he covered all the bases. And at that, they began to dedicate it all.
Yes.
And it says when he finished praying, chapter 7, it continues. It says that the fire came down.
Yes.
Amen. From heaven.
Yes.
There was a great mighty entrance.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Consumed all the burnt offering and the sacrifices. And the glory of the Lord filled the temple. This is during the Feast of Tabernacles.
Yes.
Do y'all understand what is going on here? That the Lord told them to commemorate even under Moses. He said for them and all of your dwelling places, wherever you are, that you are to remember this time. So
yes.
they did this. and they carried the tabernacle, you know, the tent of meeting, you know, and he hovered there. But during this time is when they built this elaborate, great place to place his name. And he shows up.
Yes.
The Yah of the universe shows up during his feast to his temple that was given to him and presented to him. He says, and the sacrifices and the glory of the Lord filled the temple. After the fire consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the temple, the priests could not enter the temple of the Lord because the glory of the Lord filled it.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And when all the Israelites saw the fire coming down and the glory of the Lord above the temple, they knelt on the pavement, wherever they were, and their faces to the ground, and worshiped and gave thanks to the Lord, saying, he is good. His love endures forever. Hallelujah.
Forever.
Amen. Yeah, give a man the praise.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Amen. So Solomon, verse 8, observed the festival at the time for 7 days, and all Israel with him, a vast assembly of people, from Lebo-Hamath to the Wadi of Egypt. And here we are. They celebrated those 7 days. And then it says on the 8th day, they had celebrated the dedication of the altar for 7 days.
Yes.
And the festival for 7 days more. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. So this is the same day that we're entering into right now. That same 8th day. And then they celebrated all the way from that day, another 7 days. And according to verse 10, it says on the 23rd day of the 7th month, and that is at sundown, that's what we'll be on today. We'll be on the 23rd day of the Most High's calendar, the 7th month, the 23rd day. That's the same as this evening. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Amen. So we're in sync with the Most High's calendar. Yes, we are. We are in the same season, remembering and commemorating that 23rd day.
Yes.
Hallelujah. It says, verse 10, on the 23rd day of the 7th month, he sent the people to their homes. And what were they? They were joyful and glad in heart for the good things the Lord had done for David and Solomon for his people. Amen. Hallelujah. Not only that, but after Solomon had did that great petition and all of that that went on, the Most High answered him. He said, I have heard the prayer that you prayed. It's one thing to pray something, but if you don't get a confirmation that your prayer has been heard, you're still left wondering, right? So the Most High himself, hallelujah, came and sent the word tape to Solomon and said, I have heard the prayer and have chosen this place for myself as a temple for the sacrifices. Amen. He was pleased with everything that they had done. He was pleased that they chose this time. It was all about timing. It was all about the timing. I tell you, if you really want to press the Most High, you get in accordance with his timing. You get in accordance with his calendar. You get in accordance with the way he say he wants it done. Hallelujah. We may take it lightly or think that it is not important to be in accordance with what the Most High is doing, but I'm telling you, everything that he has done has been according to his calendar.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And he is going to return. Glory.
Yes.
Amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It says, when Solomon had finished the temple of the Lord in the royal palace and had succeeded in carrying out all he had in mind to do in the temple, this is verse 11 of chapter 7, and his own palace, the Lord appeared to him at night and said, this is the passage that we always seem to quote, amen, and we're going to continue to quote it even for this season because it is a promise. There was a covenant in that temple.
Yes.
There was a covenant in that Ark of the Covenant. There were promises. Everything that it represented mean that we could do these things and expect certain things. And he says he had heard the prayer, this place for myself as a temple, when I shut up
the heavens.
Yes.
We know this so that there be no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people. He said, if my people who are called by my name, this is the Most High's word.
Yes.
We attribute this to Solomon, but this is the Most High telling Solomon. Mm. I agree with you that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land.
My
eyes will be open and my ears attentive to the prayers offered in this place. Amen. He says he has chosen and consecrated this temple so that my name may be there forever. My eyes and my heart will always be there. Amen. 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 That's our history portion. Glory, hallelujah, of this segment tonight. Glory, I just give honor and praise and thanks.
Yes.
Hallelujah, that the Lord, he always wants, is always desired to have a people that he can dwell among. Amen?
Amen.
And this is just a type and shadow. It points to greater things that are yet to come. Amen. Let's turn to Zechariah 14. We're just going to read that one scripture because it talks about how that, this is not, that wasn't the end of it. And what we do is not just something that we're doing, but this is what we're also going to celebrate in the kingdom. According to Zechariah 14, verse 16. And it says, then the survivors during that time, the end, from all the nations that have attacked Jerusalem will go up year after year to worship the king, the Lord Almighty, and to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles.
Yes.
Amen. So this is a future time. This wasn't a time that has taken place already. If you read through all of that, it talks about a time when that we're to look forward to, and it will occur, the Feast of Tabernacles.
Yes.
If any of the people of the earth do not go up to Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord Almighty, he will be the King of the earth, they will have no rain. If the Egyptian people do not go up and take part, they will have no rain. The Lord will bring on them the plague he inflicts on the nations that do not go up to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. This will be the punishment of Egypt and the punishment of all the nations that do not go up to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles.
Yes.
Amen. So that tells us that this is still yet to come in the final days, in the last end gathering, because this celebration is also synonymous with the end gathering. Amen. So I want you to go back a little bit, and we're going to talk about who are we expecting during this Feast of Tabernacle. Every season that the Most High has ordained, he brings about his purposes. Amen. In chapter 14, go back to verse 4. We know that the Most High is going to send, that he's going to fight against all the nations that are not submitted unto him. And he says, on that day, his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives.
Yes.
Amen. Our Lord will come. Mm-hmm. And it says, east of Jerusalem, and the Mount of Olives will be split in two from east to west, forming a great valley with half of the mountain moving north and half moving south.
Yeah.
And let's go down to verse 8. Yes. You can continue to read through all of that to see what's going to happen. It says, on that day, somebody say that day.
That day.
Living water. Say living water.
Living water.
Will flow out from Jerusalem.
Yes.
Half to the eastern sea and half to the western sea in summer and in winter. The Lord will be king over the whole earth.
Yes.
On that day, there will be one Lord and his name, the only name. Still talking about the name and his presence being with us. On that day, and I want to just take a quick minute. We're going to be wrapping this up pretty soon, but I just want to talk about this Why did Zechariah bring out on that day the living water will flow? These are signs that will occur in the earth. Amen. When the Most High Yah sends Yeshua back to be Lord over all the earth, he's going to be during, we're still going to commemorate tabernacles. His presence will be with us during tabernacles. He's going to stand on the Mount of Olives and it's going to split in half and the waters are going to flow. Hallelujah. Turn with me real quick to John chapter 7. Keep your finger on Zechariah because we're going to talk about hallelujah that. And one of the things during the dedication of the tabernacles, when they brought in everything, you know, they had the altar, but they also had the sea. All of these were just representations. We miss it sometimes. We don't understand what's actually happening. All of these things showing the water. They showed the blood through the sacrifices and then all the water flowing. Hallelujah. So in Jerusalem, when Yeshua was present, Pastor Lord, Apostle Overseer said, brought it out a little bit, how that the water pots would be flowing all through the city and also in around the temple. So the water flowing was always synonymous with the atmosphere of the temple as well. So if you're not sure that Yeshua celebrated the Feast of Tabernacle and you're one of those ones who say, well, I don't think we should celebrate it. It doesn't have anything to do with Christianity or has nothing to do with my salvation, then I just come to tell you that Yeshua did celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles when he was in Jerusalem, according to John chapter 7. We know it says, verse 2, but when the Jewish Feast of Tabernacles was near, Yeshua's brother said to him, you ought to leave here and go to Judea so that your disciples may see the miracles you do. So now they said this in order to try to be a little bit smart mouth with him because they thought he was doing things just to be seen. And he said, no one who wants to become a public figure or no one who wants to be seen going to act in secret. So if you really want to be seen, go ahead now because, you know, this is a pilgrimage. This is basically what he's telling them. Everybody in the whole world that is part of the house of Israel will be there. And here's your opportunity if you really want to be seen. Go down there to Jerusalem and do your works. Show yourself to the world. So basically, that's what they were saying. For even his own brothers, it said, did not believe in him at that time, right? So they're basically telling him to, you know, now's as good a time as anything. Set your stage, you know. And so, but he told them that he was not going to. He said, the time is for me has not yet come. For you, any time is right. When you're in the flesh, basically, he's telling you. For you, any time is right. The world cannot hate you but it hates me because I testify that whatever it does is evil. And he told them, you going up to the feast. And this was the Feast of Tabernacles that he was referring to. But he did go down. It talks about in verse 14, and after half of it had been completed, it says he went down to the temple courts and began to teach. And we, if you read on, he's always angering those who are against him. You know, they wanted to try to kill him, to take his life. At that time, they don't want to anger the people during the festival. So they're picking the right time of when they want to come after him. Amen. So we're going to skip over to verse 37. And this is the part that I want to share just for a quick minute.
Amen.
And because he said that he was telling his disciples that he you'll look for me, you will not find me. He was talking to the Pharisees, and they were like, where are you going to go? You're going to the scattered tribes all around where the Greeks are. And then he says, where I am, you cannot come. And then he says, on the last and greatest day, verse 37 of the feast, Yeshua, Jesus, stood and said in a loud voice, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink. Now, this last day was the greatest day.
the day that we're talking about, the eighth day celebration, where it talks about, where he says, if anyone is thirsty, come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, the scripture has said, streams of living water will flow from within him. Amen. So we're looking, listening to Yeshua talk to them as the pots of water. Now, can you imagine him knowing
that
he is the one who is to come? He is the one that's going to wrap this whole thing up. He is the feast. He is the whole, everything. Everything is the point to him. Everything is a type and shadow that points to Yeshua and what he is going to do. Can you imagine being him on this great day, knowing that he's going to stand in that place when it comes time to wrap this thing up on the Mount of Olives, and that he is going to be the one? But right now was not the time. He could have caused it all to happen. He could have wrapped it all up. Then and there was the season. But he said right now is not the time for it wasn't going to be the time for him to establish his kingdom. What he was doing at this time was doing a work in the hearts of men.
Yes.
In the hearts of them. He was bringing salvation. And he was also bringing, begin to tell his disciples about his spirit. And out of their bellies would flow these rivers of living water.
Wow.
Even the Holy Spirit was going to be a point to what was actually going to come in the visible kingdom.
Yes.
Amen. Because in verse 39 it says, by this he meant the Spirit, mm-hmm. whom those who believed in him were later to receive. Up to that time the Spirit had not been given, since Yeshua had not been glorified. Amen. And so they began to listen to him. And I don't know what it was about how he said it, whether he said it in a loud voice, maybe the place where they were trembled, but they began to say, wow, who is this? Is he the Christ? Is he the one from Galilee that the scripture speaks about? And catch this. He says, does not the scripture say that the Christ will come from David's family?
Yes.
And from Bethlehem, the town where David lived? Thus the people were divided. But these, they didn't understand that, yes, he was still, he is the promised one that came from David's family. Amen. Hallelujah. So go back to Zechariah chapter 14. It says, on that day, water will flow out from Jerusalem.
Yes.
During this day, water, can you catch the visualization I'm trying to present for you today? On near these temple grounds, water was flowing out on the eighth and best, greatest day. The Holy Spirit, hallelujah, was speaking, and the water was flowing out through Yeshua our Lord. He was telling them, if anyone is thirsty, I am who will fill you. I will quench your thirstiness. I am the waters of living. I am the living water. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And not only will I give you to drink, but I will cause these living waters to flow out from you. Hallelujah.
Yes.
And that's what we're here to do. We are here to occupy, and we are here to have the Holy Spirit, and we are here to have the presence of Yeshua. Because I'm telling you, when you receive the salvation that the Most High has given us through Yeshua, you receive the name. Hallelujah.
My God.
You become that temple. You become that tabernacle that he dwells in. You become that place that he puts his name on. Hallelujah. And not only that, you offer up praise. You have so much. You don't disregard yourself. Just like Yeshua said, I am the temple. Destroy this temple and in 3 days.
Yes.
They said, it took our fathers 46 years. Man, what are you talking about? 3 days, you're going to raise it up. You know how long it took for them to recreate this thing? Every time it's gotten sacked and destroyed, they've had to redo it again and redo it again. It's been about 4 times. And redo this temple place again. And you telling them to destroy it in 3 days, you want to raise it up again? He wasn't talking about that temple that was standing in their midst, in their presence. But he said, I am the temple.
Yes.
He was talking about his body.
Yes.
He was talking about his flesh and blood. He was talking about the spirit that was within him. He was talking about everything that he came and gave when he told his disciples, eat of me, take of my flesh, and if you, unless you drink of me, drink of my flesh, unless you drink of my blood, unless you Amen. Eat of my flesh, you will have no part with me.
Oh,
he was talking about that temple. He was talking about his own self being the sacrifice. Now, unless we enter in and take part in it, you will have no part with me. He lost a lot of followers that day. They thought he was crazy. They said, oh, he done gone crazy. He's talking about his flesh. We ain't cannibals. It's, I know there must be something in the law that talk about we're not supposed to eat flesh of men. No. We must believe he lost a lot of followers that day. All of those who came just for the meat and the drink, all of those who came for the loaves and the fishes, he lost all of those who just came for the miracles. He lost everybody that if you came for the healing, he lost everybody that came for the blessings. He lost everybody that came for to see what was going on. You had the onlookers who wasn't really willing to commit their lives to him. And all the ones who just was there just to have something to do. All of those who just wanted the fame of knowing that they touched him.
Yeah.
All of those who just wanted to be in the midst of whatever was going on.
Yeah.
Oh, they lost all of them. When they said, he said, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood. No, you can't take part in this.
Yeah.
That's right.
You can't have any of this. It goes deeper. It's more than just what you see, he says. And his disciples, he looked at them. He said, hey, he looked around. He only saw a few left. He looked at the few he had left and he said, will you also go?
Yes.
Will you also leave? The only ones who knew something was deeper about this man, about who he was the ones who got a revelation about who he was. Peter, Cephas, he had a revelation. Because when he revealed that, he says, you are the Son of the living God. He knew him on a personal level.
Yeah.
They looked at him and they said, where shall we go? You got to know. He said, where shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. You are the eternal life. You are the eternal king. You are the one in whom we've been waiting for, and our expectation has been to receive you. Because they knew something greater was supposed to come.
Yeah.
They knew that the Most High had certain promises and everything lined up with the prophecies. And so they said, you are the one that we know. You are the one.
Yes.
But just like every detail that went into the temple, all the specifications, everything the Most High wanted to see that was a type of like his, he also wants us to follow his word. And he said, where shall we? They said, where shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. This book Amen. Is all about the words of eternal life.
Yeah.
Everything that he spoke, he pulled from things that had already been written concerning him. Prophecies in Isaiah, he spoke. Other passages he spoke. All had to do with him because he was the eternal life. He is the eternal one.
Yes.
Hallelujah. He's looking for a place for us. And he was going to call us to be home with him. Amen. When he wraps this thing up and he brings his physical kingdom, he's going to call the people he has chosen unto himself. Last scripture, amen. And then we're going to go ahead and conclude with this.
Bless you, holding
it. Revelation chapter 3. Messiah makes a statement to the church in Philadelphia. Amen.
My God.
He says in verse 10, since you have kept my command to endure patiently, this is the reward. I will also keep you from the hour of trial that is going to come upon the whole world to test those who live on the earth. He says, I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have. so that no one will take your crown.
Yes.
So that no one to take will take your crown. So that no, he told them, you're going to go through some tribulations and some trials, even in their time. And this is also a word for us as well. Hold on. Amen. We already know what Yeshua left for us. He gave us the Holy Spirit to help us through these tests and these days of trying. Hallelujah. He said, hold on. So that no one, so that no one will take your crown. Him who overcomes, listen to this. I will make a pillar. Are you reading this?
Yes.
I'm telling you, when I read this and I was studying this, I got chills because I was just studying everything in the physical temple, every element, everything that all the table, the showbread, the outer, the inner court, the curtain, the outside, you go outside, you see the pillars, everything that is before the Most High. And he wanted to look down on earth and he wanted to see it as well. And Solomon had pillars. Pillars and everything and the pomegranate, everything was so beautiful. But Yeshua tells them, he says, I will make you a pillar in the temple of my Elohim, in the temple of the living God. I will make you a pillar. Amen. Does that give you chills to think that you have a place? Hallelujah. If you just hold on to what Amen. He says. He says, I will make you a pillar. Never again will he leave it. Never again will he leave it. Are we reading that right? Never again will he leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city. This is that tells you that we're not just talking about a physical temple that is made by hand. We're talking about he looks at you. He looks at you. He looks at you and he sees a tabernacle that he wants to dwell into. Hallelujah. And place his name. Like when they dedicated the temple, his presence came and he filled that whole place. Hallelujah. That's what the Most High and his spirit does in us. Hallelujah. He says, never again will he leave it. He will never leave us and he will never forsake you. I don't care what you're going through. If you feel as though you just are just here all by yourself. No, that is not the truth. That is the work of the enemy to make you think that he is not with you. Because he said, I will never leave you. He will write his name. Amen. Those who overcome, these are the promises. These are covenants that he has. He's going to uphold. And he says, in the name of the city of Elohim, the new Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven.
Yes.
From my Elohim. And I will also write on him my new name. He who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Amen. Does that, if that doesn't excite you, I don't know what will. I get excited just to think that my living right now, hallelujah, I purify. That's why we purge and we purify ourselves and we give, present ourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to the Lord, which is our reasonable service. It's not too hard.
No.
It's a reasonable service. Yeah. It's not reasonable. It's not more than what you think you can handle or more than what you can do. It is a reasonable service.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Presenting ourselves. We are the sacrifice. We have sin in our lives. We need to burn it up.
Yeah.
Amen. If we want to have fellowship with the Lord, we need to present to him a peace offering. Hallelujah. When we come before him in our time of prayer and praise. Hallelujah. We're doing all of that. All of that. All of our prayers are going up before him. Hallelujah. Because he chooses to dwell with us. Hallelujah. And we just give your name the praise, Lord. We thank you.
Yes,
we thank you for this opportunity that we have had to share. Hallelujah. We thank you that you understand and you know. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You know what you see when you see us. You know what you want to see when you see us.
Yes. Yeah.
You know we're not like you, Lord. when our ways don't please you, you tell us, Lord, to study to show ourselves approved, to repent of our sins.
Yes,
God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, in this house. We just ask that you would help us on tonight, Lord.
Yes, God.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. We dedicate our lives to you, Lord. We dedicate our own temple, our own place,
yes,
Lord, that we could be a habitation for you,
Jesus.
A habitation for your presence. And anybody that's watching my live stream, Lord, if you haven't given your life to the Lord, he wants to dwell with you. He wants to come in and supplicate with us. He wants to dwell with us. Hallelujah. We invite you in, Lord. Hallelujah. We want to love you with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength, Lord. Teach us your ways, O Lord. Teach us your ways that we come before you, Lord. Hallelujah. Teach us how to love you. Teach us how to work worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We bow down to our to your throne, Lord. Yes, Lord. And we thank you.
Yes, God.
I have such gratitude. I am so grateful for him today. I don't know about you, but I am grateful for everything. Hallelujah. I could have been lost. We could have been left to die in sin. But he saw fit to come to us. He saw fit to give us the sacrifice. Hallelujah. Of our Savior, of our Lord Yeshua, who died for us, knowing, oh, hallelujah, what's in the future. He sees our future. And he wants the best for us. Hallelujah. And if anyone doesn't know him or doesn't want to know that they are not where they need to be, we can pray the prayer of salvation. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We come before him.
Bless your mighty
he name. Wants to tabernacle with us. Hallelujah. This can be a new life for us, a new season, a new day. The eighth day can be the greatest day, and we enter in, hallelujah, to this greatest time in our lives. Because when he wraps it up,
you are my shelter.
Hallelujah. We only those who are righteous will enter into the kingdom with him. Hallelujah. Amen.
Yes, yes,
amen.
Yes.
Pastor Moore, do you want to? Amen. Lift us up in prayer on tonight, and he will dismiss us. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Bless your great name.
Yes, God. Yes. Yes. Compliment. My God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank God for the word.
We bless the mighty one today. We thank the Almighty for the word. Hallelujah. I trust that the word challenged each one of you. I trust that the word caused you to think.
Yeah.
In the future.
Yes, it does.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Bless your great name.
Saints, it's so important that we regard everything that the Almighty has established. The reason why I say this is because in my own religious upbringing and coming to Messiah, we were taught that these Moedim were not necessary. We were taught they were not essential, that Yahshua just fulfilled them. You know, you don't have to do it. When you read this book in its entirety, what you discover is when we get into the millennial kingdom, the time when Messiah rules and reigns, according to Zechariah,
yes, yes,
those who survived, because there's going to be some survivors, and they're going to have to submit to the King Yahshua during that 1,000-year period.
That's right.
Hear me. Everybody's going to have to come up to celebrate.
And for those who are not familiar with what the plague was, my wife didn't read the details on what the plague was. But I'll share what the plague is. Amen. The plague is just basically incineration, where you will be burned up to ashes. That's what the book says. Mm-hmm. Said that the people will stand there and their eye sockets will disappear. They will incinerate. Mm-hmm. See, everyone who does not submit to the king when he is ruling on the earth will perish, literally perish. Now, for us who are ruling and reigning with the Messiah, we already know. We already know what to do. We're the obedient. We already know what to do.
Yes.
But I'm communicating this with us because it is important that we who live in this age where there are so many voices and so many different things being taught, we need to understand that if we believe this Bible as we say we believe this Bible,
yes,
there are things in it,
yes,
that we have to accept.
Yes, yes.
And many of our brothers and sisters who disregard these Moedim of the Most High fail to understand the importance of what they should be doing now. Are you hearing me? Because this is what our Savior practiced. This is what he celebrated. This is what he did. Some that may be watching me, you might be from a Baptist background, you might be from a Pentecostal background, you might be from a Presbyterian background, and you were told that, no, all I need is Jesus, and I don't need all of that, he fulfilled it. One of the things you must understand in the history of the Messianic Israelite community is that they continued to celebrate these Moedim,
yes,
these feasts.
Yes, they did.
They didn't stop.
That's right.
Are y'all hearing me?
Yes, yes.
They didn't stop. It continued.
My God.
And if they continued it, then what give us the right, mm-hmm, to say that it should cease?
Yes, yes.
Are we better than the previous apostles of the first generation? Are we better than the ones that they gave the instructions? Are we better? Do we have more wisdom?
No.
Do we have more revelation?
No, sir.
I think not.
No, sir.
Thank you,
but
Jesus.
I want to encourage Zion today.
Hallelujah.
I want to encourage Zion today.
Hallelujah.
Keep his way.
Hallelujah. Bless his great name.
Regardless of what others do, if you've been informed, keep his way.
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Let
us stand at this time. Bless the Almighty. Bless the Almighty.
Thank you, Father.
I just want to pray over each one of us here in this place before we speak the final blessing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah. If you're in need of Elohim to answer certain things in your life, I'm just going to pray and come in agreement with you. And my desire is that flow of living waters, that flow of living waters.
Yes, yes, Lord.
Messiah said,
yes, Lord,
that out of your belly shall flow rivers of living waters.
Yes, Lord.
And there may be some that may need to have that flow. You may have had that flow at one point, but you may need that flow again. Sometimes, as they used to say, you need a refilling.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm going to pray in connection with where each of you are. Hallelujah. So that flow will happen in your life. Everywhere you go, you'll have that flow. Hallelujah. Stretch your hands out to the Most High today. Abba Yah, I do thank you right now. I bless you for the promise of the living waters. You said that if we believe on you, as the scripture has said, that out of our bellies, our innermost being, shall flow rivers of living water. I pray, Father, in Yahshua's great name, that you would cause the rivers of living water to flow out of the being of each one assembled.
Yes.
I pray that you give refreshing. I pray that you would give renewal. I pray, Abba Yah, that you would refill again with your Ruach. And I pray that you would give power. I pray, Abba Yah, that you would cause your people here in this place today to do greater things for you.
Yes, Lord.
Now, manifest that in their lives.
Yes, Lord.
Manifested through gifts.
Yes, Lord.
Manifested through signs.
Yes.
Manifested through wonders.
Yes.
Manifested when they pray and cause your great name to be exalted.
Yes.
Father, I thank you in the name of Yeshua.
Yes, Lord.
Bless your people in this place.
Yes, Lord.
Encourage their hearts in this place. Take their praise to a higher level. Take their prayer life to a higher level. Take their commitment to a higher level. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
May fire be ignited in their spirit.
Yes.
Fire be ignited in their spirit.
Yes, Father.
In the name of Yeshua.
Yes.
Now we thank you and give you praise.
Bless your great name.
Hallelujah.
Bless your great name.
Hallelujah.
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 Glory.
You're the most high praise today. Hallelujah.
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 Bless
the Holy One of Israel. Encourage, strengthen, and empower
your people.
And we will bless you. Hallelujah.
Yes.
The Most High be praised.
Yes,
Hallelujah. The Most High be praised.
Hallelujah.
I want to encourage you to start to expect things to begin to change in your environment.
Yes,
I want you to begin to
expect
for things to change in you. Hallelujah.
Yes, yes.
Begin to walk in another level of praise and thanksgiving. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
I don't care what your circumstances are. I don't care what they look like. I don't care what people tell you. I don't care what the doctor may tell you. I don't care what. It doesn't matter. You need to focus your mind and your eyes on the Redeemer. And allow him, through your faith, to begin to make known and reveal his mighty acts in your life.
Yes.
There's nothing too hard for him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Expect new things.
Hallelujah.
Bless his holiness.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yes, it's
hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Yes, indeed.
Hallelujah. Bless the mighty one of Israel. For those of you who are watching us by live stream, I just want to say to you, if you consider this teaching and ministry that you've heard to be a blessing to you, that it has encouraged you, that it has given you a word, if you have heard the voice of Elohim in the preaching, that you would just begin to give the Most High thanks and praise. I also want to encourage each one of you who may be watching to sow a seed unto the Most High. You can go to our website at www.ncmmi.20m.com and you can click on the donate button, or you can share by Cash App. Our Cash App code is $NCMMI. You might say, well, Pastor, you always request for the people to give. Why is that? Because the Most High, he told Zion that anytime you come before me, he said, do not come before me empty. One of the ways in which we offer worship is by giving. This is something that the Almighty commanded and expected while the temple stood. When they would come up to Jerusalem, They would already come with their animal sacrifice. They would already come with their gifts. They weren't asked. They already knew to come. That was a part of the worship. This is why each time we gather, we request of the saints to give unto the Almighty, because the Almighty commands it. He says, when you come, don't come before me empty. We don't offer sacrifices on altars because we don't have the temple. We don't do worship like that during this phase. But we can offer unto the Almighty from that which we have as an exchange for those things that are necessary for the work of Elohim. And so we encourage him to give monetarily to him. And for those of you who are assembled today, we also encourage you to give unto the Most High. You can present your gift in the receptacle after the final blessing. Hallelujah. The Most High be praised. You can have your seat, saints. Hallelujah. I want to thank my wife for sharing the word today. I appreciate her time of study, and I appreciate the information that was brought to us.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
It is so important that we're able to see the connection.
Yes, yes.
The connection.
Yes.
There's a reason why there were waters that were flowing on the eighth day. I told you about the water pots. Because the Messiah stood up and said, just as they were seeing those water pots flowing with that water, what did he say? He said, if you believe on me as the scripture has said, out of your belly shall flow the rivers of living water. And so it is so very important that we remember these things. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you for sharing the word. At this time, let us stand to our feet. We're going to speak the final blessing and be dismissed. And we're going to share together in the food and fellowship that we have. Hallelujah.
Yeverekeka Yahuwah. Veismareka Ya'er Yahuwah Panav. Ileka, vikuneka, yesa Yahuwah panav, ileka, veyesim leka shalom. Now may Yahuwah bless you and protect you. May Yahuwah make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May Yahuwah lift up his countenance upon you and give you shalom. Avinu shalom aleichem, our Father's peace be upon you. Shalom to each and every one of you.
Shalom.
Hallelujah.
Shalom.